Welcome to the first lecture of the occasional online lecture series organized by Essen School of Arts and Communication. We also know it's an auspicious day because it was on this day Ambedkar converted himself to Buddhism along with a large number of his followers. Today we have with us Yes Anand, a distinguished personality who has carved a name for himself in the publishing world by exclusively focusing on anti-caste themes, aesthetics, and politics. He's the co-founder of the prestigious publication Navyana. It's become prestigious over the years. He is the co-author of Vimayana, the graphic biography of B.R. Ambedkar, of which we're going to talk in a short while, and Ganja Mahua Chronicles, the story of the artist Venkat Raman Singh, he has annotated critical editions of Ambedkar's writing, Annihilation of Caste, Riddles in Hinduism, and Beef, Brahmins, and Broken Men. He describes himself as a poet, translator, and a student of Draupadi music. Interestingly, he's also an alumna of this university and is part of the English department. Today, Anand will discuss the production and reception of the graphic book or novel, graphic novel Vimayana. Like other contemporary graphic novels and illustrated books that use folk and tribal art, Vimayana is a product of collective and collaborative labor. The text is composed by Sri Vidya Natarajan and Anand himself. The artwork is by the Padon Gaur artists, Durgabai Vyam and Subesh Vyam, and the publisher, of course, Navyana. The book is based on the autobiographical notes of Ambedkar, culled from the section Waiting for Visa. John Berger has written a foreword, and I quote, "A conference of corporeal experience across generations, full of pain and empathy, and nurtured by a complicity and endurance that can outlive the market," in some ways saying that it cannot be reified easily. Another commentator in the recent past has observed, "The work is emphatically political and didactic, and it is undoubtedly the most successful attempt to integrate Indian folk art and the English language narrative, despite the fact that the artists are themselves illiterate." With these brief remarks, I welcome Anand to make this presentation and flag off the first lecture in the series. Welcome, Anand.
Thank you, Thirumal. Thank you, Essen School, and everybody who has made this possible. First, Jai Bhim to everybody. And I recall this was the first book published by Navyana, which ended with the words Jai Bhim. The epilogue ends with me saying Jai Bhim. I said, I've been known to be a partisan publisher. And as part of this partisan nature of running Navyana, first I would like to reflect a bit on this occasion, which is Ambedkar's conversion day, of course, the day he decided to formally step out of a religion which had reduced him to an untouchable. In 1935, he says, "It was not in my hands that I was born a Hindu untouchable, but it is in my hands not to die as one." And then he writes Annihilation of Caste, where he really sets the dynamite to the Vedas and Shastras. And in 1956, on this day, 64 years ago, he embraces Buddhism with, you all know that story. And in some sense, when I recall the story of how and why we did Vimayana, I cannot but think of several of my friends and authors, and you don't know, for watching this, you could be under UAPA. We live in very dark times, but I still, on this day, hope that one day I will not be calling myself an alumni of just HCU, but I hope this university will eventually, on a day like this, let's dream about it being renamed Rohit Vemula University. It's on that note of concern and solidarity, and solidarity with all those people who are languishing in jail, who's got to face murder and rape. It is in this background that even the idea of running or starting Navyana happened. So, Thirumal's suggestion about 2 weeks ago made me really go back on down memory lane, because it's 10 years of Vimayana by this January. And The idea of this book started sometime in 2007. Before I jump to that, I'm going to talk about how it all came about. So this is, I suppose, out of the 60, 70 people here, most of you have at least read Vimana or seen it more than reading it. It's a book to be seen as much as read, because there's a visual way of reading the book, seeing into it. And I realize now, when I think back about the multiple editions, the book has gone through the 10 languages, including 6 Indian languages, all the 4 South Indian languages, Kannada, Telugu, Tamil and Malayalam, plus Hindi, plus Marathi. Then there is, suddenly out of the blue, somebody reads it and then says, we want to publish it in Korean. And then I didn't even know any Korean publisher. This happened through an agency. And then a left-wing member of parliament in South Korea wrote a foreword to the book, which I can't read. Then there was a French edition. There was a Spanish publisher who fell in love with this book. Why did I go around taking one of the biggest iconoclasts of our time and iconizing him like this? What was the reason? What impelled me? What compelled me? If you really look at what led to Bhimayana and what led to Navayana, it's a series of missteps, misadventures on my part. On my part to try to grapple with caste, work on it, work towards equality by publishing books that spoke of it. So one of the early misadventures or adventures was with Dalit Media Network in Chennai, roughly around 2000, when I was working with The Hindu. And as a sub-editor, you had to do an 8-hour job. You went to work sometimes only at 4 p.m. and returned home at 10 o'clock or 12 o'clock. So you had the day to yourself. I was reading up a lot of Ambedkar on those days. This was the first time that I laid my hands on the volumes which are actually behind me here, Babasaheb Ambedkar Writings and Speeches volumes, which I procured in Chennai. And then I got in touch with the Dalit Media Network, which used to publish a monthly magazine called Dalit Murasi. And they were looking for somebody who could help bring out a journal. Long story short, I initially Dalit editor. Didn't happen initially. So I was given the responsibility of bringing out one or two issues and finding a Dalit editor in the process. And the first person who happened to be, she has subsequently been forced to, Meena Kandasamy is the person I have in mind when this was being put together. This was the first time Dalit History Month, a call given by Ravi Kumar was announced in, this is in April 2003 we are talking about. Now you see here the germ of Navayana's logo as well. This is a illustration for an Aravinda Malagathi fragment from his autobiography called Government Brahmana. And the person who did the artwork for this is called Chandru. You can see his signature down there. His full name is Chandrasekharan, but everybody in the art circles of South, especially Tamil Nadu, would swear by Chandru as one of their teachers, gurus, as their ustad. And I had the fortune of meeting him several times, befriending him, smoking bidis and Chota Gold Flake with him. And I was told that he's notorious for not doing commissioned illustration if you went to him. Punita Pandian, the editor of Dalit Murasi, was telling me, go try your luck. So I wanted it to be the cover and also the key illustration for the Aravinda Malagathi excerpt. Government Brahmana went on to become a book because it was first excerpted here and it was, I think, eventually published by Orient Black Swan, Orient Longman. So this becomes effectively a seed when I am 1 year down the line, the Dalit is brings out 3-4 issues, it's shut, and Ravi Kumar gives me a call saying, let's start Navayana. I don't want to go into all the stuff that led to the making of Navayana, but I want to tell you what the first book was. So this is the logo now. You can see how the previous image. This is two buffaloes kissing, a he buffalo and a she buffalo. The she buffalo is a Dalit and the he buffalo is a Savarna, and they're not supposed to mate, but the she buffalo is in heat. It manages to elope with Savarna, Vokkaliga owned he buffalo. It's a wonderful story which is reproduced on the Navayana website on our About the Logo page. Do later find the time to read it. What you see here is effectively book number one of Navayana. When the idea of saying let's start Navayana came about, it was simply by saying, you know, you couldn't go to a bookshop and buy books of Ambedkar. Even now there are very few bookshops. We see an Amazonification of the world, but back then in 2001, 2002, it was impossible to walk into a bookshop and except Dalit run bookstores, except those places. I'm talking about regular mainstream, Landmark, Odyssey, these kind of big bookshops where big publishers sold their wares. So Ravi Kumar's idea was, let's start a publishing house that will take our kind of ideas about him, even reprint Ambedkar perhaps. And he said he has always been fascinated by this little fragment which comes to 13 dense pages in volume 12 of Boss, waiting for a visa. So these are autobiographical fragments, and back when I read them and back when Ravi Kumar read them, we had no idea as to how they had come about. Retrospectively, now I know that in 1935, all these episodes that he narrates in English here were serialized in the Janata, the newspaper that Ambedkar back then, which means the people, the newspaper that he ran. Look at the kind of names Ambedkar chose for his very non-sectarian universal names, Janata, Mooknayak, Prabuddha Bharat. So here he is sitting in a very unconventional, not in a three-piece suit, so which is the reason why I, but back then there was no designer, nothing. We just did everything together. I was employed with Outlook magazine by then. And again, I had a lot of time to myself. And effectively, the first few years of Navayana and these books were made literally in the Outlook office, side job, as they say. So this was priced at 40 rupees, 30 pages. Then there were three other books that we published and launched. And this was primarily a reissue with Ravi Kumar's introduction of Ambedkar's Waiting for a Visa. And back then, Ravi told me, who went on to become an MLA, he's currently serving MP for the Vidyalaya Sirthagal Kachchi from Tamil Nadu. He told me, you know, this Waiting for a Visa should be actually an illustrated book. I said, the word you're looking for is graphic book. He said, yeah. So let's do a graphic book. So I got I had grown up on comics in my childhood. I was not somebody who started with literature with a L capital or literary books. I read my first novel shamefully only in my BA because it was there. And then my basic staple during my younger years were from Tintin to Asterix to Amar Chitra Katha to all kinds of comics, good, bad stuff, and not really graphic novels, just vulgar, common, popular comics. Then when this idea was seeded in my head by Ravi, I said to myself, let's go back to Chandru, the person who is one of the best artists in the country even now. He's retired. And I said, why not get him to do the book? So nothing came of it. But before that, before we actually worked on Ambedkar, we had another book. And the reason why I continue to grapple with Ambedkar and what he has to, the kind of, this is something that I didn't even read when I started Navayana. This is from the Buddha and His Dhamma. And I'm going to read out this passage to you. Why is it that you stumble your way and still embrace an anti-caste cause, even if you're not a Dalit, which I'm not? So Ambedkar says something in the Buddha, to realize that every living being will die sometime or the other is a very easy matter to understand. But it is not quite so easy to understand how a human being can go on changing, becoming while he is alive. It is on account of sunyata that everything becomes possible. Without it, nothing in the world would be possible. It is in the impermanence of the nature of all things that the possibility of all other things depend. Sunya is like a point which has substance but neither breadth nor length. And the connection between what Ambedkar is saying here philosophically, you know, it's like a standalone thing. You can pull it away and call it a great sentence, a great thought. And it made me think about Gond art, as it's come to be called, Gondi art sometimes, Pardhan Gond art. It was something that started not by tracing its life on paper and canvas and such, but on walls. We will come to that part of the story later. And it was meant to just evanesce. And what Ambedkar is also telling me here, and people like all of us here, is that when he moves towards Buddhism, it's a constant, endless process of change. And that is what makes me continue to do the kind of books, despite the critiques that even I am going to make of myself today. So before we approached Durgabai Vyam for Bhimayana, in 2007, you had what is now become known as Mandal 2, and you had anti-reservation stirs and pro-reservation stirs, of course, but the anti-reservation ones were more highlighted by the Savarna-dominated media. And there was again people sweeping, like it happened in 1990-91, upper caste doctors, Brahmins, others wearing coats and sweeping streets, and complete lack of appreciation of dignity of labor. So Kancha Ayalaya came up with an idea which he initially didn't want to even do it with Navayana. He was asking my help to publish it with other publishers. But there was nobody willing to actually take on this Ayalaya book and get it illustrated. I had no idea. I had not even by then thought of doing a book like this at Navayana, because one started with regular prose books. And this was a different order of things altogether. It required a different kind of thought. Then I thought, okay, why not Navayana do it? And I asked Ayalaya, since others were refusing you, three or four publishers refused him or didn't really respond positively, dragged their feet. Then I decided to do it, helped it recast it a bit in a child-friendly way instead of purely, it is a didactic book, but in terms of material, in terms of things to do, what to do, how to make it school-friendly. And I had no experience of doing it. I stumbled along and did something. And I was looking for illustrator after illustrator, and I approached Chand again. I said, okay, he happens to be a Dalit person, maybe I said it earlier or not. He doesn't like to be labeled as a Dalit artist, obviously. And he is somebody who I really wanted to work with on this book, but we went on a trip for 4 or 5 days to a hill station. He did nothing. We just watched movies on my laptop and came back with literally. தமிழில் சொல்லணும்னா படம் போடுறதுக்கு பதிலாக நாங்கள் படம் பார்த்துட்டு வந்தோம். ஸோ ஐ வாஸ் ஸ்டில் ஸ்டக் வித் நோ ஐடியா ஆஃப் ஹூம் டு கெட் இட் டன் பை. தென் ஐ அப்ரோச்ட் ஒன் ஐஐடி பாம்பே ப்ரொஃபஸர் கால் ராஜா மொஹாந்தி, ஹூ ட்ரூ வெரி வெல். ஐ டென்ட் வாண்ட் சம்படி ஹூ குட் இலஸ்ட்ரேட் வெரி வெல், ஸோ டு ஸ்பீக், ஃப்ரம் சிட்டிங் இன் தேர் டெஸ்க். ஐ வாண்டட் சம்திங் எல்ஸ். ஐ டென்ட் நோ வாட் ஐ வாஸ் லுக்கிங் ஃபார். அண்ட் இன் ராஜா மொஹாந்திஸ் ஆஃபீஸ் இன் ஐஐடி, ஹி டீச்சர்ஸ் விஜுவல் கம்யூனிகேஷன் அண்ட் டிசைன் ஐ திங்க். There was this painting hanging on the wall and it attracted me. And he said, do you know who this is by? It's by Durga Bai Vyam. Oh, I said, I've seen Tara Books, one of their expensive limited edition handcrafted books called The Nightlife of Trees. I said, I've seen her work there. It's beautiful. Then immediately, this was late at night, 11 o'clock, he's smoking a cigarette, I'm smoking a cigarette, and he says, why don't we approach her for your book instead of me struggling with this? I said, totally agreed. Let's try to not have a Mohanty doing it. Let's get a Durga Bai Vyam. It was too late to call. The next day, calls were made. I didn't even have the money or budget to travel to Bhopal from Bombay. I came back to Chennai. And everything that Durga Bai Vyam did for this book, about 12 or 13 single page illustrations, were done over instructions on the phone, discussions on the phone in Hindi. And the word being constantly used even in the article that Thirumal cited, which I take serious objection to, not because Thirumal used it, but because people use it, is that Durga Bai is illiterate or Subhash Vyam is illiterate. I prefer, if we have to use some word, unlettered, because if you look at literacy as something that's about visuals, and somebody who has done 10 books, published 10 books, and some of them have won the top awards at the Bologna Ragazzi Fair in Italy, The Nightlife of Trees. So she is author of probably 15 books by now. So to call her illiterate is a bit of a problem, especially if we do not know how to read the language in which she is presenting to us. So this was the first effort, and this book did not really make waves like you can see on the screen here. UNICEF India recommended it. The Telugu translation of this book sold 17,000 copies, or the government purchased it and distributed it in schools. So several schools also bought in bulk. Ayalaya helped us buy find some people who would bulk buy copies of this book. Otherwise, it was out of print for 7 or 8 years, and I revived it now again because of popular demand. There was a time when it would just sell 100 copies a year. Unlike Bhimayana, which has been a constant seller over the years, so much that it has sold 5,000-6,000 copies in the last 1 year. Bhimayana this year has sold more than it did in its first year, which is why we are talking about it. When I met the Vyams about this book, Durga Bai immediately said, I want to work with Subhash, my husband, on this, because this looks like a very ambitious project. And they had been, over the years, this Turning the Pot happened in 2007, and they had been asking me, give us something big and more challenging. This was so easy. you're turning the pot, tilling the land. They did in 1 week, the illustrations were done and I got them. And I must also admit to you that back then, Navayana's resources was so poor that I probably paid something like 2,000 rupees per painting, which was given to that book. And then I continued to pay royalty. But the scanning cost came to as much. Back then, drum scanning of these images was an expensive affair. So when we started Bhimayana, Durga and Subhash had no idea about really who Ambedkar was. So I explained to them. Then their daughter Roshni Vyam, who was 14 back then, who has become an author of a few books already, at the age of 24, 25. She took us to Newmarket and showed us a portrait of Ambedkar and says, this is the, oh, we have seen this guy, the guy with the pointed finger. Now you see the cover. He's holding the constitution, of course. This is from Chandraban Prasad's village in Western UP. The name of the village is not coming to my mind. And you can see here how Ambedkar is depicted. And you can't call this Gundi, tribal, folk. The kind of words we end up using when we classify art are also a part of a certain way of categorizing, which is akin to classification of the Varna order. We immediately want to categorize things immediately. I do not know who made this very striking, pretty statue. Ambedkar's wearing a polka dotted tie, and it's a kind of a mauve suit he has. He's got the constitution, and he's got nail paint. And here's Chandraban looking the part with a three-piece suit in his own village. You can clearly see the building behind is not an expensive one. There's not even cement covering it. This is one way of looking at it. Does he really look like Ambedkar? When does Ambedkar begin to look like Ambedkar? We don't know. And if you go to the Vyams and ask them to draw the same picture over and over that Ambedkar must resemble, they're going to start giving the iconic things, the spectacle, the finger. So they use these very things which are there in popular discourse and made them see a lot of images. And here he is at the back of the book holding the constitution. So the core of this book, equally its author is Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, because it is based on Waiting for a Visa. And the reason I approached Sridhya Natarajan, who also happens to be an alumnus of Central University of Hyderabad. By then she had written a novel. She has done a PhD on Sadir and how it came to become Bharatanatyam from the very university where I studied. She was my super senior. So I knew her, and she had done a lot of children's books for Karadi Tales, Tulika. By then she had she somebody who could dance, sing, do many things. So, and I thought she could storyboard this because I didn't know how to do a storyboard. And her storyboard came with very typical graphic novel instructions, and the kind of problems it led to we'll soon see. If you go 1 hour away from Bhopal towards Bimbetka, the caves, these are what you see, and this I find a very comic moment. Look at the way the person to the left of your screen is running away, and this big beast is coming for him or her. We don't know the person, the figure. This is also from Bhimbetka. Bhimbetka is about 25,000-year-old caves, about 1 hour from Bhopal. And Bhopal is the city where Durgabai and Subhash live. Back then, all I knew about Gond art was there was this person called Jangad Singh Sham who committed suicide in 2001. And he was the one who was brought to the city by this J. Swaminathan, the textbook version of the history. And Gond art transitioned to paper, first to canvas and to big galleries through Jangad. And after his passing away, Tara and other publishers start looking at it as a possible way of getting illustrations done. They could be illustrating Greek mythology stuff to other stories to just about one, two. I remember one of Durgabai's early books was called One, Two, Three. Not three, but tree. So you could call it what one of the reviewers of Bhimayana had called, you know, selling ethnic cheek to an international audience. All that was happening. So at that time, you found Gond art being solely done to do wonderful, beautiful animal stories, Savarna-friendly picture books, something political. And this is an image you're seeing on your screen is from Lascaux, cave in France. And for me, drawing starts before what we formally arrive at as writing. So here was all this with the, in the background and thinking of how, what is a graphic book. So I would show them all kinds of graphic book, including Phantom. So if you see how a story moves, it's regular and there is a close-up, there is a top angle. All these are there in Srividya Natarajan's storyboard. Now, how are you going to communicate this to somebody who does not believe in perspective, light, shadow? Most of the time, throughout the book, you'll see eyes are just looking down at you. They don't do front eyes, they do only profiles. In most Gonda till I suggested we try something new. And then you had Amar Chitra Katha, again following the same kind of a template. Men and women with six pack. Here you have the great god Krishna with other, another six pack, brutally killing somebody and everybody having gladiatorial fun there. These are from Amar Chitra Katha. This is what you get. It's the same Western format of what is called sequential graphic storytelling. The biggest seller for Amar Chitra Katha was the book on Krishna and Mahabharata. It sold hundreds and millions of copies. And whereas when they attempted to do something with Ambedkar, because Navayana is not the first one to do this. Let's see it. So in Amar Chitra Katha, again, stereotypes. How do you show a Brahmin? How do you show a stupid looking scholar? How do you portray him? With this tuft. This is, of course, Chanakya. And how do you portray asuras? You can look at the color contrast. This is a very simple way of telling us history and mythology and packaging it as all so that today those who rule can rule the way they do. And this is up to Bahubali, where this particular tribe is shown as pure evil, rapist, bloodthirsty, and their language is never subtitled in the sense that what they speak is such gibberish that it doesn't need any subtitling in any of the languages in which Bahubali was made. We do have popular cultural references. This is from Mysore, of course, around Dasera. I want to briefly talk about a book that took on this, because mostly this gets left out. Navayana was not doing Bhimayana in isolation. When we did this book, it didn't have the kind of wonderful, joyous reception that Bhimayana, for many reasons, has continued to have. This was more graphic. This was Phule, who is different from Ambedkar, and the book is different. It demanded a different kind of. It is based on his Gulamgiri, which was written in 1873. And Phule is unsparing in spoofing and caricaturing Hindu gods, their beliefs, Brahmanic myths of creation. And it, by then, we did this book did not have any funding, whereas Bhimayana did. So we did a black and white version. You will see the problem images here. So now this, nobody invites me for as many seminars on this book as say on Bhimayana. Here you have Brahma menstruating. He's putting a sanitary napkin on his mouth. This is how Phule talks about him. Did he have four vaginas? Did your Brahma have four heads? If he had four vaginas, how did he give birth to Brahmin, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra? This is there in Gulamgiri. There he is with a tampon on his mouth. There's a close-up shot by Aparajita Nainan is the illustrator, and Srividya Natarajan again did the storyboard for this. And at Navayana have constantly, it's not as if with Bhimayana we ended our engagement with the iconography of Ambedkar. This was a book that came, I felt that this was a kind of a contrast to Bhimayana, because here you have uncharitable cartoons drawn of Ambedkar collected by Unamati Shamasundar, a scholar from JNU who happens to be Dalit. And he was doing a very clear Ambedkarite Dalit history and a reclamation of imagery and writing out the context in which Ambedkar was constantly being belittled, attacked, made fun of. And there are 121 cartoons here, and none of it is a pleasure to see, simply because, unlike with Bhimayana, which is everybody says it's so beautiful, though we have problems with it. Whereas here, it's only problems that you encounter. So the reason I'm telling you about this recent book that came out 2 years ago is that our engagement with the imagery of Ambedkar and the production of a certain kind of image making of Ambedkar, all these are conscious decisions. Now, before we actually come to when I moved to Delhi in 2007, I had been given this Young Publisher of the Year award. I decided to throw my Outlook job and see if I could run Navayana full time. And back then, I used to function out of my friend and designer of Navayana Books, Akila, her office. She had a design studio. And Navayana did not really have a shelter. If you remember the image that was sent around on Facebook everywhere of the shelter image, which we will come to, Navayana literally gained a shelter in Delhi, rented a first office because we had to do Bhimayana. And then I went around looking for funds. I wrote to India Foundation of Arts, I wrote to various people. Everybody said, no, oh, this doesn't meet our funding criteria. Who's this coming from? Are the artists wanting to do it or do you want them to do it? Asked Durgabai Vyam to write an email. She did not have email. She did not do any of these things. And yet we did write handwritten Hindi things and then scanned and said, no luck. Then luckily a friend from Chennai, suggested that I write to Prince Klaus Fund in Netherlands. They are an arts funding group, and I back then Google wasn't that big, but you could still find out. Prince Klaus Fund is a royalty of Netherlands, and surely they are giving away money for good causes because they made a lot of money with slave trade and wily bad capitalism and such stuff. So this is the remnants of monarchy in Netherlands doing some good stuff. So they gave us, after 6 to 8 months of back and forth of emails and proposal writing, a generous grant of about, if I recall, about 12,000 euros, which was very generous. Because I knew the kind of labor that would be going into this project, and I wanted to compensate the Vyams well and subsidize the production of what could be a four-color book. But back then, after all this came in place, Navayana had an office, and I used to spend days together in Bhopal trying to brainstorm how the book could be. And then first thing I had to do was translate it into Hindi. The translation, I was not a good judge of Hindi, still am not, was bad. And there were several problems. And Roshni Vyam, the daughter, helped the parents navigate the text both with the Hindi and English. In terms of trying to frame the story. And for weeks together, months together, they would draw full page drawings, and Ambedkar would not look like the same person in the next panel. How do you deal with these issues? And how can I do each instruction as a full page? And then it would be a 400 page book. We have to do a 100 page book. How do we do all this? One fine day, Subhash Vyam, sitting in Delhi in the Navayana office, came up with the idea of the Digna. These are basic geometric patterns that they do across the walls of their homes. Now they resemble fields, patterns that they see. And these are pure abstract drawings. And he just did this in the course of about a few hours that day and showed to me these are the various ways in which we can fit this to. First thing they said is we're not going to put people into boxes like you do in your graphic novels, no panels. We don't want to stifle things. So it should be khula. And when Bhimayana was happening, I didn't really understand where this was organically, say, coming from. I just said, okay, it looks like a good design solution. Now, this is into 2013. Bhimayana is published in 2011 by Jan, and I'm working on it from 2008 onwards. In 2012, Venkat Raman Singh Shyam, who happens to be a nephew of the legendary Jangad Singh Shyam, walks into my office and said, you did Ambedkar's book. Ambedkar is famous, so people will buy his book and read. Will you do my book? I am a nobody. I used to ply a rickshaw here about 13 years ago. Now I've become a well-known artist. I want to tell my story, my autobiography. So I won't bring in that story entirely here. So because of him, I said, let's go to the starting point of this. Where did this art start? So we went to Patangad, which is the village surrounding which is Sanpuri, where Subhash Vyam comes from. Sijora, where Venkat Raman Singh Shyam comes. All of them come from a cluster of villages around Patangad. And Patangad is the hub. That is where I would say somebody, the equivalent of Rembrandt, was born, which is Jangad Singh Shyam. So here, this is a regular drawing, what you're seeing, done on a wall just to decorate. No longer is organic paint and stuff being used. This is just distemper. And this is the woman, young woman, she was 16, Rameshwari, who painted these things. on these adobe walls. And back then I remember her telling me, you know, I make me an artist, let's go to, take me to the city, otherwise they'll get me married here. And 3 years later when Durga and Subhash saw this, wo to uska tha shaadi ho gaya, meaning she did get married. So she didn't make it to the city and become a big artist, no. So the book that I ended up doing with Venkat, Finding My Way, helped me understand a lot of things I had already done in Dubai. So here I am admitting to you that even today when I open it and look at pages, there's something new that emerges. Because if you look at a page even like this, there's so much happening. You just can't say I read this and I spent a minute or two on this and moved. It demands that you engage a little more deeply than what the words will allow you for. That book had a very short life because it was an expensive 12 square inch hardback, and then it became a smaller sized black and white. Because of color, a book's production cost usually goes up. Back to Rameshwari in the home in Patangad, which led to those two books eventually in 2016 and 2019. Anybody in the audience wants to come in and take a guess at what you're looking at here? Anybody wants to have a shot at this? This is a cow shed. I don't know if anybody is able to hear me. This is a cow shed. Even a cow shed is kept as prettily and beautifully as this.
Oh.
Yeah, sorry. I heard that too late. I wasn't sure whether... So if anybody's listening in, I would like to stop for a few more moments later with other images. Here I've given the game away by saying it's a cow shed. You can see the pole there. And there I was like a tourist clicking away pictures, and I used to be clicking away at every wall because every wall was, and this would not last. This would just be there for a few months. Next season when they have to paint their houses again, it'll be gone.
Anand, so Anand, sorry to interrupt, somebody actually did guess it was a cow shed before you.
Oh, right. Okay. How do I see
section,
that?
Actually, people are also answering in the chat section.
Okay, okay. I'm not seeing the chat because I'm focused on the presentation.
Yeah, so Kevin Frank Fernandez actually answered it was a cow shed before.
Okay. Thank you. So there it is. It is a cow shed. How do I see this chat function?
Right beside the share screen. It's right beside, there's a box right beside the share screen. Click on it, you see it. It'll be better if you stop sharing, it'll be easier to do that, but you can do it later, it's not a problem. If you want,
I'll learn to do that better. Yeah. Now.
No problem.
So now I want you to again look at these images and then look at what is here, which I saw only in 2013, by the way, on the walls of a house, and see what is happening on one of Bhimayana's pages, early pages. This should be page 7 or so. So Subhash came up with this amazing design solution, Digna mein bitha denge. We will fit the story into this Digna and that will give us a flow. So we'll be able to do, otherwise they were taking one full page just to say this much. So this would effectually become 6 pages, which was not going to get us the work, help us get the work done. And they would create scope for, because of the way they drew and because the storyboard kept changing and one had to write according to how they drew, things were added. Namdev Dasal's poetry came in later, Etahelka news item came in later, and the discussions and interactions with the Vyams and literally their immersion into the story over several times, they would have to tell the same story over and over again. And because they also were used to this way of narrating a long-winded story. So we would add masala, we would talk about what could have happened, kaisa beta hoga. And now here is Ambedkar being denied water in a school and the hand pump is being shown as a woman in this case. Those of you who have copies of the book, if you go to the very opening page, which is starts at a bus stop. You'll find two figures sitting in a bus stop, and all that one told Durgabai and Subhash there at that point, the brief was, you need to draw a shelter, bus shelter. And they came up with a person with a hair spread like this across. Here you see the peon of the school telling Ambedkar to go away. And I initially used to ask Subhash, what is the point of these four hands? What are they doing? Why are there three extra hands getting out? So he is telling Ambedkar, go away. The emphasis is being given by these pointed fingers. And later Ambedkar uses the very pointed finger in the iconography around him and in the book throughout. It was the speech bubbles were actually done towards the end of the book because it was really space being given allotted with a rough pencil sketch for these things. And I said, we'll do the speech bubbles later. And today, let me admit that this speech bubble idea of making them bird-like was mine, and the idea of making them scorpion-like was Subhash, because we were just jamming and brainstorming. And on that day, I received a compliment from Subhash. He said, oh, now you have begun thinking like a gond after all these months. Yesterday I was reading up on what kind of reviews and such have come around Bhimayana. The very first important review that I read and that has stayed with me, which I went back to yesterday, tells you what this book does in terms of this juxtaposition of images and the particular way in which Gond art is used in this book. And this is from Nandini Chandra's review in 2011 from Biblio. I'll put it on the screen. Two contrary storytelling styles vie for space within the comic. One, the mythic Gondi style, which enacts the stories. The other, the reportage, which tells it through facts exchanged between urban educated upper caste class citizens in newspaper reports. The Gondi style makes it possible to live out the horror and therefore does not need to furnish proof of it. This mythic world naturally rejects the realism of different physiognomies or the need to differentiate between Brahmin and Dalit on the basis of skin color, skull size, relative flatness of the nose, and so on. The Gondi interpretation of Ambedkar's autobiographical notes restores perspective by enacting an embodied horror through such things as scattered body parts, a telling comment, the scattered body parts that you saw just now, a telling comment on a Hindu moral economy that is hierarchized on the basis of anatomical splitting, head, shoulders, hands, torso, feet, by drawing an equivalence between disparate body parts which are shown to be swimming in a non-symmetrical frame, the hierarchy is smashed. Indeed, these strategies are far more effective than a scorekeeping of the innumerable acts of violence inflicted second by second on Dalits in India today. So, for me, what the reason to not go to a more regular established graphic artist or established modes of doing graphic art was also because I was looking for how does one conceptually capture something that is deeply violent and yet restore dignity to this way of seeing. Now, here you have Ambedkar as a young boy. In the scene before, this is a zoom of what you, close-up of what you saw here. To your left, there is Ambedkar saying, sir, may I drink some water? And it was not part of the storyboard, no way anybody told. I was just so overwhelmed by the image when I first saw it. Ambedkar is shown here with a fish thirsting inside him. Now contrast this with Amar Chitrakatha, which did its book in 1979, I think, the one on Ambedkar. The text is also makes him look very pathetic. In fact, the Amar Chitrakatha, which was done by the Amar Chitrakatha Ambedkar comic, opens with a Brahmin-like sage walking across the village and telling Ramji Sakpal, the father of Ambedkar, that he would have a son who would become a very great man. So it's almost like a prophecy. So the myth-making starts from page one. And if you look at what exactly, who are the people behind this book? This is one of the covers. There have been many covers. Sorry, I've made a slip there. It is Dilip Kadam, not Dilip Kadam. Dilip Kadam happens to be an illustrator who worked with Amar Chitrakatha for more than 10 years. Nandini Chandra has done work on Amar Chitrakatha books. She discusses his life and work. He happens to be, in Nandini Chandra's words, a Mahar Dalit. That is a person belonging to Ambedkar's caste. And he and S.S. Rege, who did the script for this book, happens to be a close associate of Ambedkar and was a librarian of Siddharth College. Now, this is the kind of book which is, for me, also deeply problematic because of the myth-making it indulges in, the Hinduization of Ambedkar that it partly goes along with, and a standard template of telling the story. If you think about it, this would have sold more copies than the man. Now, I'm again going back to this 2013 February journey with Venkat, where I saw these images, the kind of panels and graphic designs that they came up with, Durgabai and Subhash, for the book, was something that was part of the village life. Not they, where they live in Bhopal, they live in a regular flat, a regular house with modern amenities. This is a kitchen. And these are the ways in which the pages of this book have been done. This is a woman who painted her own house. Each room you visit in a house in Patangad will make you feel like you're in a gallery. The book opens with a tribute to Jangad Singh Sham. For those of you who have not read the book, I hope you will after this. This is one of the pages where Ambedkar has just returned from the US and he is headed to Baroda in a train. And a very pesky Brahmin is asking him questions about where he... Now, this is not part of the waiting for a visa thing. So some of this stuff was added as to make the story come alive. But it is not something many people have commented on yet. And you do have Durga and Subhash asking me, now, a Brahman ko kaise dikhai? How do you show a Brahman? So tuft, you can see the little hair popping out of that person's head. And he is chewing paan all the time. And he's asking nasty personal questions to figure out, and he assumes Ambedkar must be a good Brahmin. This is one of my favorite pages in the book. Here again, the idea was to look at the heaviness of the text. Frankly, we got away with it simply because it was so important to put Ambedkar in his own words. Just like we created fictional situations, we equally stuck to his words several times about the great statements that he makes. This one is his 1927 Mahat speech, and I gave them the whole background because we are not Mahat Satyagraha could get an entire book, but we were just doing one or two pages with it. And connecting, it's not part of, again, Ambedkar's autobiographical notes, part of his waiting for a visa. This was sewn into the story. Now, the fact that Ambedkar is giving this speech, they told me, is like, is coming through these panels and it's like water is being spread out. It's like their thirst for equality is being quenched. And here are the two sutradhars at the bottom, still debating about whether Ambedkar is a good man, whether caste is an issue. People have read all kinds of things into these two sutradhas who remain unnamed. People have assumed that the woman with spectacles is like an Ambedkarite figure, a woman who is a Dalit, who is teaching this South Indian, likely Brahmin fellow, a lesson in history. So the purpose is didactic. Uh, I must tell you that when we were midway through the book, we wanted to stick to the waiting for a visa template and end it with a series of acts of experiences of untouchability that Ambedkar speaks about, and intersperse this with contemporary stories which are very similar to Ambedkar's experience of humiliation and discrimination, and end it there. And then before we eventually published the book got ready about 6 or 8 months before it became available. I used to make copies and share it around to get feedback, to get critical feedback, where are we going wrong. So one of the persons who read it happened to be Jerry Pinto, sitting in Bombay. And he came to know about it rather than, you know, he didn't read the initial copy. He told Joe Sacco, who is one of the finest graphic writers. He doesn't write graphic novels. Again, he's a nonfiction writer. And I managed to get his email ID, write to him. And he read the book, gave his feedback. And one of the key feedback that we got from him was to finish the story, take it to the constitution, talk about the Gandhi Ambedkar thing briefly, so that we get a rounded sense of this is your opportunity to tell people like me. So why did we do the book? The reason was you could go. I was in London in 2007 for the Young Publisher Award. And it was impossible to tell somebody from Romania or Hungary what this whole issue with caste and Ambedkar and Dalits and what they had no clue. So they have no idea. They said, we have got our own set of problems. Somebody from Libya would say, no, I don't boo me with this. Give me a book which will make me want to know a little more about this. So the graphic book idea, which was already seeded by Ravi Kumar, caught fire there and kind of saying, I'm going to come back home and do this and make it work. So that if somebody says, I have no idea, and lots of Savarna Indians are so indifferent to these kind of stories. When we launched Bhimayana, I used to be, if it's a Savarna-filled audience, I would sometimes ask if anybody knew where Ambedkar was born. So a lot of people would not even know where he was born. So this was the kind of ignorance and prejudice as a background for which one felt like you say you need to break this by making this book. And here's Durgabai and Subhash trying to show Ambedkar. What do you think is, I'm going to try to look at the chat service. What do you think is happening here? I've removed all the text in this particular image. What is Ambedkar being depicted as here? Yeah, there are answers in this chat saying Buddha, which is true. And he has got a Ushnisha coming out of his head, which is the top knot of enlightenment. And in unlike, and there is an image of a dark black Buddha which I purchased in Nepal once from Kathmandu during a trip. It's sitting in our office. There's a black wooden Buddha and it has a Ushnisha. And here Subhash was interpreting it as people. And the Ambedkar is like educate, agitate, organize is happening around here. And then the top knot of enlightenment is people. Here, Ambedkar has just returned. This is a chapter, the three sections in the book. One is water and the other one is shelter. And in when the section shelter begins, we thought of having these chapter openers and Subhash came up with this idea of showing Ambedkar like this. And this is one of my favorite pages. Because at that point, when he drew it, I asked Subhash, what are you trying to say? He said, you're a very well-read person. You figure it out. And when I figured it out, it took me a while. He was very happy. What do you think you're seeing here? Somebody in the comments is asking me about an earlier image. Isn't this Gandhi? Because the specs are round, Ambedkar has kind of oval specs all through. Well, it's a fair question. That's the ambiguity that it creates, so much that Nandini Chandra in her review looked at one image on, if any of you has this book, go to page 57. I'll see if I can suddenly stop share and show you this page. On this page, there's a person taking a dump in what looks like a pond. And one of the reviewers saw that as Ambedkar taking a shit in, I mean, sorry, Gandhi, because of his, there was a tuft with that person who is taking a dump in the pond. And they thought it is Gandhi doing it. So just the round rim spectacle, that's why I'm trying to tell you that with this artwork, Ambedkar is not going to look exactly the same, even within a page when he moves. You're going to associate certain words with him, certain ways of speech with him, and certain, so there is no particular way of drawing a nose. There is sometimes a very sharp-nosed Ambedkar. And in this case, does anybody want to have a shot at what is it that Ambedkar comes back, and you know the incident in Baroda. He's left homeless. Nobody wants to give him a place to stay, and he's forced to quit. He hides himself as a Parsi. He fakes his identity as a Parsi and tries to get admitted to a Parsi inn. He's kicked out of there too. Somebody has said, Ashipra Gupta says, his travels and the fact that he had to go door to door after being turned down shelter everywhere. That's true. But how exactly is Subhash trying to do this? If you focus on the image, there is a three-piece suit and it's got certain things jutting out.
I think, can I go
sure,
on?
Please. Yeah. Sure.
I think it's very symbolic that kind of fonts are coming out of his shirt when he's holding his bags of books. That that becomes his burden all the while that he's looking for shelter. Books that were supposed to emancipate him from this caste or you know, get him above that, did not help him. Kind of, there is a moment with Ambedkar where he feels like his books have failed him, and maybe that's why there are, you know, thorns coming out where.
But if you see thorns, what is the immediate signification of a thorn? You're right about the thorns. Somebody else was raising their hand. Thorns, repulsion, somebody, Madhulika, has said here. What you see on the top of the building, wind vane, self-defense. It's interesting that vehicles have the form of animals. Now, one of the things that Subhash immediately told me, matlab wo kante hai to chewenge nahi. So he says, untouchability is being shown simply despite his many accoutrements, many accomplishments, his wonderful attire. He's going to be judged for what he was born as, which is an untouchable. So kante, the thorns, make you think that he's untouchable. And he's between two worlds. The blue hand points to the sky. He doesn't have a shelter on this earth. He eventually finds himself spending 6 hours in a public park because the train is only in the night. He's been kicked out by the Parsi landlords. And the kind of response that this book has had in terms of, I'll also talk about the reception of Bhimayana. A lot of schools, now Delhi University started prescribing it since 2013. And it is taught as part of the BA compulsory English course. So that creates a new kind of audience. Then there are lots of students, sometimes when these elite schools used to call us for workshop, I used to think, why should we go and teach these elite schools about Ambedkar? And then I changed my opinion when one of the teachers there said, you know, I studied this book during my BA, and I think it will make a difference to these even rich kids if they came to know a little bit through this. It's been such a difficult time for me to get this book into the syllabus. Now, don't say you won't do a workshop. So after that, I started doing workshops in elite schools as well. Now, again, for me, I understood this page better 2-3 years later. When I was seeing this image, this kind of a landscape way of showing a certain figural way of showing what is happening with Ambedkar, with the landscape which is there in eastern Madhya Pradesh. I'm coming to the close of my hour now, so I'm going to stop. This is finally, you're seeing Durgabai and Subhash at the office of Navyana. Me sitting in the middle. And we are doing these, they were summoned back to Delhi to do extra pages. They used to literally live, cook, live, sleep. I used to make tea all the time, bring them food, help them with resources. They used to live in the office and get the work done. That is how Bhima and I got done. I would go to Bhopal, spend a few days. They would sit and work there, bring the work, do the finishing touches here. And these are the pages of the roundtable conference, which come towards the end of the book. Stuff done after Joe Sacco's suggestion that we kind of round off the book with Ambedkar's conversion and the constitution. Subhash is sitting, and most of the work is not done standing or anything or on a table and chair. It's always done sitting down. These are exactly 10 years ago, September 2010. You know, after Bhimayana, when it was being done, a lot of friends said, what is this Gond art and Ambedkar? How are you going to make people believe that this is Ambedkar even and that it has to be a book that is worth reading? The very first review for Bhimayana was a negative review in Tehelka, but I was undeterred. Well before we had planned a 6-city launch, I tied up with Caravan magazine, which was up and coming those days, reviving itself. And they would get to put their little logo there, and then we would do events in Bangalore, Bombay. We started on the eve of the Republic Day in Bombay, January 25th. Then we went to Kochi, then we went to Bangalore, then we went to Chennai, we did a launch, then we did a launch in Delhi. So it was within a month we were going. This was the first ever time that I organized a book tour with Subhash and Durga going everywhere. Today, they're not there with us for this presentation for several problems. I mean, they would speak only Hindi and it would be difficult to communicate and on this online thing. They're not used to it. And anyway, this was something that I wanted to share as my journey as a publisher. Even today, when they look at the book, they look at it with admiration. They went on to do work in the Kochi Biennale in 2018, thanks to their work for Bhimayana. So this was a book, the photo that you're seeing here is from London at the Nehru Center, where we organized a launch. I managed to make, I had manic energy back then, 10 years ago, I was much younger. So the India tour culminated in April. April is when London Book Fair happens. I ended up combining things. There was a Ambedkar International Center, kind of a Dalit-led group there, which bought 500 copies of the book to distribute among Ambedkarite circles there. This is where Patrick French and Meena Kandasamy came to speak over the book. Eventually, to this launch came the publisher from Tate Publishing. The Tate Gallery has a publishing division. And they published the UK edition of the book, but unfortunately it didn't do well. I have a fear that they even pulped the copies. We did manage to get them to print a lot of copies, but I did get photographs of it selling for £2 much later when it was remaindered. So I'll stop here. I'm sure there'll be questions once I stop sharing my screen. So Jaybeam again to everybody. What you see again here, which we began with, is a wall in Patengar. And I think it's a beautiful painting. Jaybeam, and thank you. So Thirumal, should I hand it back to you?
Thank you. Thank you, Anand. I'm sure you must be having comments, suggestions.
Yeah, I'm reading the questions. I read them once in a while. The blue hand points with this kind of drawn towards the earth.
Can I ask a question?
Please.
Yeah.
How long did the book take in totality to complete, from you writing the draft or thinking about it to the illustration part of it and then getting it published? How long did that period last?
I would say all in all about 2.5 years. The process started sometime mid-2008.
Okay.
Roughly around April 2008. And the book realized itself by the end of, by the last photograph that you saw of them sitting and doing the final pages, 2010 September. So by October 2010, the cover had gotten done. So it was roughly 2 years and 5 months is the time that it took. This is after I managed to get the Prince Claus funding and other things, because effectively you have to be prepared to, we had rounded up everything, like saying we are ready with this is our team. But how do you go about doing it? So that took about, if you then look at the, from the ideation stage to getting funds for it, etc., give it a good 3 years.
And how long did the illustration take?
Once, the first 2-3 months, like I earlier said, were a bit frustrating because of the single page nature of thinking, and I won't put people into boxes. How do you move the story? So this impasse was for about the first 4 months, I would say. So it took quite a lot. I used to spend time in Bhopal. They used to come here, and we were literally at our wit's end when finally Subhash cracked the problem with his design solution. So that, from that day on, if you really look at it, once they got into the rhythm, once we okayed the pages, like this is the way it's going to, this is the rhythm. I think they finished the actual work in about 3 to 4 months. Once we cracked how to do it, it didn't take too much time.
Okay.
But and there would be gaps. There would be gaps.
I think sometimes I missed this part, but I just want to confirm again, like, how were you getting funded for this project, and how were you surviving during the time that the book was being created in terms of funding?
Since I made a presentation which said about all that duty, so maybe if this is getting recorded, you can say that. I explained all that in detail in terms of fundraising and what we did. It was Prince Claus Fund which funded the book. No, since you are a graphic novelist,
right, in Netherlands. Something
with Navana, we will talk this about this later. So those sure. things I've already addressed sure. since others would have heard it.
Anand,
yes.
I was thinking, and of course, coming from some of the writing that I've already commented on your book, how do you reconcile the tension between folk art and the English language narrative? One speaks of capital, the other speaks of a resistance to a certain form of reification, at least in some sense. But then you also see they don't have to stand in juxtaposition. That's a position you seem to be taking. Isn't that right?
See, first of all, when one sees art like this, one immediately decides it is folk art. And second, one sees a graphic book of this quality, immediately say, is it for children? So there are several layers of, and it is not at all a wrong thing to do, because I think on a hunch, I can tell you that 60 to 70% of the audience of this book could end up being children, actually, who are consuming the book for other reasons, which, and nobody in this discussion today is actually a child. Maybe as a child, they read it, and now today they are 25 or something, you know, because I've heard those kind of stories. So when you talk about what kind of an audience is it reaching, what kind of politics is it conveying, what is the politics of using this folk art for something juxtaposed. Now, anything that you publish, whether it's for 395 rupees or 100 rupees, you're going to put it out. All other Navyana books also have prices similar to this. And this is a subsidized price. Now, for me, I was not looking at it as folk art. I was looking at it as art, which really makes you do a take, a double take, a triple take on each page. You don't need to read a Batman or an Amar Chitra Katha two times to take in the art. Rarely do you stop, really. There is, of course, complexity. It's not as if to say drawing Superman and Batman is easy. There is a visual language which they carry, a baggage. Which is why when we approach something like this, here you're allowing a different kind of imagination and an empathy to inhabit a certain mode of thinking. Now, Durgabai and Subhash have no direct experience of untouchability. And why are they doing this book? What if I had also told you that when you take a Dalit artist and produce an Amar Chitra Katha kind of book, nobody is talking about it as a Dalit text. Not necessarily. So here it was a coming together, what I think was of an association of people, moved by a consciousness, which was on my part instilled by me into the Vyam, saying that this is a figure. Now, Roshni Vyam was availing, say, reservation. Ambedkar had his problematic views on Adivasis, but do we then say Pardhan Gonds, because they are Adivasis and because of a certain history of tension between what Ambedkar said in this, cannot illustrate this? Then who, as a person, how can I, being a non-Dalit?
Anand, the couple of things in the chat, maybe you have to address.
Sure.
Anand, I have one small question, and it was very interesting to hear your complete journey. When your book was gifted to my daughter for her 10th birthday, now she is actually 12-year-old, when she saw it immediately, she tries to relate it with some of the anime characters, because they are used to look into the animes. Different animes, basically most of the animes are Korean, Japanese and Chinese actually. And when I was trying to tell her about Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, then she says outside pictures are different and here it is entirely different. Why is it so? I'm just trying to understand, like, while discussing, you just said that you have been to some of the elite schools and some of the students and teachers are trying to receive well about the book and trying to understand it. So, I just wanted to know if we really wanted to introduce that book at the age of 8 or 10-year-old child.
When
we expect them to understand.
Yeah. Well, I have a friend who told me that she introduced this book to her niece when she was 4 years old and she's still been reading it. She's 6 now. When we published this book, I was trying to resist, frankly, the label of it being a children's book. I was thinking it's a serious graphic book. Why do you infantilize, especially when it's Pardhan Gond art or tribal art, as folk art, as you come to call it. Immediately when you see that, why do you say it is for children? When you see Arijit Sen or Sarnath Banerjee or another Bengali male Bhadrulok person doing it, why don't you see it as a children's book? What is it that immediately makes you infantilize this kind of a book? Then Srividya and a few others also told me, no, don't. It's actually the children who would be much more open to the idea of a kind of a joyous representation, something like a challenge on a page, something like a puzzle on every page. And these puzzles and visual clues are being given everywhere for you to sit and linger on a page beyond the words. Which is why I read out that Nandini Chandra review, which talks about the contrast between the words and the images. And I've admitted, and it is very clear, I don't even need to say this, that how even a child being, as he grows up Ambedkar, they never look exactly similar in two pages or even within a page. And yet, how do you relate to that kind of a representation?
Anand, you have Kevin, Frank Fernandez, Chinar Mehta, and Professor Usha Raman.
Sure. Good afternoon, Mr. Anand. Yeah. My name is Kevin Fernandez. I'm from the Department of English, Indian Institute of Psychology and Research, Bangalore. Okay. I used to be with the Department of English, Christ University. And we had an excerpt from Bhimayana prescribed in our syllabus. Former to your text, we had Sharad Kumar Limbale's Akarmashi. Mm-hmm. And Bhimayana replaced Akarmashi. And in my experience teaching, I can tell you that what Bhimayana has done for our students, no other Dalit text has managed to do. Because unfortunately, Christ University has a very elite student community, upper caste, largely upper caste and upper class, and the realities of caste were far beyond their purview. And when we took Akarmashi to the classroom, they absolutely rejected it, saying that this is something that has happened somewhere far behind in the past, perhaps because of the laziness of having to read an entire autobiography. But for it to be presented in the graphic form, right? Especially because, you know, in the Sikh university circles, tribal art, anything that is tribal, anything ethnic, automatically gets more social currency. So to tell a story of one marginalized community using the language, what you call the visual language of another marginalized community, really gave it tremendous social currency. And what we tried to do for so many years, right, with various writers, including Meena Kandaswamy, including various other writers, and what we failed to do with their writing, Bimayana managed to do with the beautiful marriage of the graphic novel form and the Gond art. So I just like to really thank you for you together with the Vyams for what you've done for towards educating all of us about.
Thank you, Kevin, but I also feel a bit saddened by your comment, because what you said right at the outset was Akarmashi was something that they did not respond with any grace and empathy, and that it left them completely alienated, and it was a choice between Bimayana and Akarmashi. And if it's for an adult audience, I would say it shouldn't be a choice. It shouldn't be. It is unfortunate that it is a choice. And this is where, you know, you unwittingly risk saying that, you know, Bimayana has got this pretty picture, so it's more palatable to a certain kind of a Savarna audience. And out of these 10 editions, 30,000 copies that we have sold over the years, I'm not sure, but it's simply impossible for us to figure out who is buying and reading this book, how many Dalits are reading it, how many Savarnas are reading. There's no such data that's available. So I would be very worried of also falling into a trap of showing something that is horrible, because throughout in Ambedkar, it's not about the Ambedkar never, and remember that waiting for a visa is not written like Akarmashi. People like Anand Teltumde have also made the point that Dalit autobiography of a particular mode, starting from Baluta down to Akarmashi down to Yutan, foregrounds a certain kind of a victim-telling story. Whereas with Ambedkar, when he writes his autobiographical notes, as we tend to call it, waiting for a visa, he uses some instances from his own life and instances from the lives of several other people around him to say that what affects him, even as a suited, booted Dalit returned from with a degree from US and UK, would affect a person trying to teach in a school, or a woman who's got fever and a doctor will not touch her. He's illustrating. He literally calls them illustrations. So Akarmashi is a different kind of text, but I am worried, not because these are two different kind of works which have different kinds of reception, but because of the rejection of Akarmashi by elite students, so to speak. Then they have to read Baluta too, which is even more hard-hitting, hard-hitting in a different way.
I mean, I think the problem is that...
Chinar!
If I can just
sure.
Respond to sir. What I was just saying is that the formerly Akarmashi was described as part of the additional English course, which is across the university. Of course, we do read a lot of Dalit scholars and Dalit writing in our Indian literature courses. This is a course that cuts across various streams, various departments, and social sensitization is sometimes completely lacking. You know, sometimes even things like gender, people are completely blind to. That is the kind of bubble that a lot of our students come from. And Akarmashi perhaps was too jarring for them. The disjunct between their urban lives, their very affluent, very privileged lives, and the world of Akarmashi was, I'm guessing it was far too much for them to bridge that gap. And perhaps, I mean, it's really sad, but Bimayana kind of eased it in for them, you know, and it opened up possibilities to have other kinds of conversations, which they completely closed the doors to when they read Akarmashi. Akarmashi just felt like another work of historical fiction for a lot of students.
So, Thirumal, we should move to Chinar.
Yeah, Chinar, Chinar, and then Usha
Raman.
Yeah. Thanks for your presentation. I have two questions, and I think you kind of addressed the first one. What I was going to ask was, who did you imagine was going to be the audience of this book? Did you, for example, imagine that it was going to be a majorly Savarna audience? I mean, of course, there's no data. You can't tell that way. But from the aesthetics of the book and the kind of stories that it is telling and so on, did you, you know, what kind of an audience did you imagine you were writing for?
Second question.
Yeah. And the second thing that I was thinking about was that you mentioned that you added details that weren't in, say, Waiting for a Visa or other descriptions of Ambedkar's own, his writing about his life. What did you think of this intervention as probably someone whose lived experience has not been to have faced this sort of a discrimination and to add details to that kind of an experience? So, for example, even with the image of Ambedkar with thorns on his body, that is an expression of embodiment of untouchability, which I don't know. So how would you address that sort of politics?
Sure. See, when we did this book, I was just thinking of everybody should be reading about him. How do I go to, especially for instance, when Ambedkar writes Annihilation of Caste or wants to make the speech, it's to a Savarna audience. If you see riddles in Hinduism, he will say this is to awaken the Hindu masses which are in a slumber. So he's constantly addressing, because the Savarna audience has to change the way it thinks. Now they don't know much. I don't need to tell Dalits Ambedkar was born on 14th April 1891, 14th October is this, that. This, we don't need to. A lot of Dalits know this, they know the basic Ambedkar story. So at one stage, I was wittingly and unwittingly performing the task of saying, let's take Ambedkar to a wider, different audience. And second, we also need to think of the younger. When I grew up, I had no mention of Ambedkar in my school textbook. Maybe in passing as the chairperson of the drafting committee of the constitution. If you look at it, the NCERT textbook with the problematic cartoon, which they refused to remove, against which I protested among others, along with others, was something which was refreshingly better and different than anything we read in our schools. So Ambedkar is making inroads simply because of the Dalit movement. What I'm responding to in mid-2000s and leading up to 2010 for Bhimayana is about the felt need to create a book that will try to bridge this divide instead of saying who is going to read it, because I can't really answer that question easily. Then when it came to the Vyams depicting fish inside Ambedkar or showing him with thorns or this Ushnisha which is rising, they had complete artistic license as long as it was not something that was, of course, I did not have experience of untouchability, nor does Srividya Natarajan have. But what we were doing when we were doing these, because when you're doing a storyboard, you're not taking, this is not an illustrated book. There is movement, there is speech bubbles. So you have to create jumps and situations. It opens at a school where Ambedkar faces discrimination. So one goes back to Dhananjay Ki, reads various incidents, reads Mahat Satyagraha into this. So that's why it's not exactly Waiting for a Visa. Mahat Satyagraha doesn't figure in Waiting for a Visa. But when you read Ambedkar thirsting, sitting outside the school, school and saying, I can't get water and I have to go home early to get a drink of water. That, and then finally leading to saying we are going to assert our rights and establish the norm of equality, we are equal. There is a connection between that thirst and the fact that Ambedkar quenched what is a public thirst. So these kind of interventions are not done with any malafide intentions. And second, in terms of the artistic license that these people get, I'm using a word which is much abused, but in terms of their imagination, what they brought to the page each time and made me think about this in such a, it just lifts up the page. If the same thing had been done, say in the Pule style, the book, somebody earlier asked me a question, these two books came back to back, Gardner in the Wasteland, which I told you, that's so in your face. Pule is in your face. You won't find Ambedkar talking like that. So that book was black and white in your face, and Aparajita Nayanan walked into the office as a St. Stephen's graduate, not a Savarna Hindu, you could call her a Savarna Christian, very anti-reservation, very blasé, no idea, very good with art. And I would make her, I mean, literally, she would break down when I told her, look, come on, you can't be anti-reservation in your lab, you can't work as an intern in my office. She came as a design intern. She went on to learn anti-caste thought, just like, you know, somebody was asking me on this a question. If the Vyams were affected by the marginalization experience by Ambedkar or found resonance with their own lived experiences, and if yes, how did it influence their engagement in the process of illustration? This is Poonam asking me. Now, when I told them this story, they immediately felt that their daughter sometimes was, she was also not very forthcoming about being an Adivasi in Bhopal, going to school. She said, not exactly. But when it came to reservation, I said, this is exactly where you will find it. She said, yeah, there do you do sense it. And she realized that this reservation has come through Ambedkar. Till then, she had no idea. So in terms of empathizing with Ambedkar, the Vyams did say that back in their villages, they did look at Chamars differently, the few that they knew. And they would do better. But by the time I met the Vyams, they were kind of, I would say, to an extent Hinduized. For instance, Durgabai was vegetarian. These personal habits had changed once you come to the village. There's also a trans. There's a lot of Adivasi artists who are very pro-BJP also, some of them. So I cannot really effect a transformation in every person who reads this book or every person who participates in this book. After this, they could have, for instance, now, it's just not with Bhimayana. They would go on and do a completely different book. Suppose somebody else came and said, let's do a different kind of a book on a different kind of a subject, they might do it. So this is where what Thirumal was earlier warning us about. What is happening to so-called tribal art? Now, there are several people who make them paint vases and mugs, t-shirts and such. These are also being hawked. So what is the politics and ideology of that compared to this? Very different, very different. It's like, I sometimes think in 7th century, when artisans were at work, people were making sculptures, they would have happily commissioned a Shiva statue from a Tamil sculptor and equally a Buddhist statue. They would make both the artists. What is their ideological affiliation to the subject is not, for me, that important as it being an ideologically driven project from Navayana. I would keep the distinction in mind. I'm not going to say that the Vyams became complete. They brought into a certain story and narrative in history and filled it with a kind of empathy which I am not capable of.
No, I think Usha is waiting.
Yeah. Thank you, Anand. It was great to listen to you and learn a little more about the backstory of the book. Some of my question has been answered already in, you know, the questions that were asked earlier. But what I wanted to know is, what's the afterlife of something like this, right? So you've engaged in this collaboration. I mean, it's a very, from the telling, it was clearly a very intense collaboration. So how is it possible then for a form like this, you know, the graphic form, to become then a language that that people take and tell stories of a different kind using this form? Or are you finding anything, you know, that has come out of this that was unexpected?
After Bhimayana, I swore that I'm not going to do another graphic book because it's kind of a labor-intensive also capital-intensive kind of a project. If Prince Claus Fund hadn't bankrolled us earlier, and they were so happy with the product, because finally it's product, but the result that came out, that when we approached them, for instance, now the Hindi publisher is going to sell it at 195. Tamil publisher says, I can sell it. They, out of solidarity, I managed to do a multiple language simultaneous edition, where, you know, in printing, you can just remove the text, which is black. Only the text, if you remember, is deliberately black. So you remove the text and put another black plate there. It will become Telugu, it will become Hindi, it will become whatever text you want it to become. So we did a simultaneous print run 1.5 years after the first edition of Bhimayana of all the languages. And back then our distribution wasn't good. It took more than a year to sell the first 3,000 copies. So if you really look at it in terms of afterlife, I was thinking, okay, I'm done. I'm not going to do another graphic book. And in walks Aparajita Nainan. I basically at that point had this idea of Ambedkar, Pule, Periyar, three graphic projects. Okay, it stopped after Pule, and then it's also the kind of work that it demanded. And Pule didn't get. It took 3 years to sell. I was thinking it'll just fly after Bhimayana's success. Mm-hmm. No, people. One of the people who bought 20-25 copies of Bhimayana every year for a child's birthday party, a friend, she said she looked at this book. Oh God, it mentions menstruation. She says this. It's explicit. It talks of rape, it talks of things in a different way. It's like a slap in your face compared to the apparent gentility of Bhimayana.
Yeah.
apparent gentility. Why do I say apparent gentility? Because if you look at certain pages, like where Khairlanji, there's only throughout the book, those who have a copy, take a look, there are eyes staring at you. Eyes in profile. Yeah. Rarely do they do this frontal thing like you and I are seeing each other now. Mm-hmm. And I used to ask them why. Only, and it was not actually, it's important to look at the acknowledgements and look at the half a dozen or 8-10 vyams there mentioned. There used to be cousins walking in. Somebody was actually a farmer in their village, comes to the city for 1 week, and he starts drawing. Mm-hmm. There were about 10 people who worked on Vimayana. Let me be frank. The masterminds were Subhash and Durga. They would draw the outline and say, hey, though, isko bharo. That intricate dot, line that you see is something where you become an apprentice with a master.
Right.
Durga and Subhash did it with jungle. So they do it here. So they this whole process, and then later I said, I'm not going to do another graphic book. And the third one that happened was Finding My Way with Pankaj, because he simply walked into the office and demanded that he be heard. And his art was so powerful, so different. And it is in Finding My Way that I came to terms with where exactly is this art coming from and what am I doing with it. And after that, yes, Madhubani artists have walked into the office. Various people would call and say, I want to work on a book with you. It is difficult to keep doing these books and keep raising money for them, because these are cost intensive, time consuming.
Yeah.
Yeah.
One last question. I think we have to wrap it up after that.
Oh.
It is from Ani. I can't get this person's name. Annika. It's on the chat.
Yeah, go ahead, Annika.
Yeah, I asked, I wrote that, but I'll ask it here, that can Vimayana be called a Dalit text? And while we were discussing, I found that the name Dalits or Adivasis or tribal communities, we used kind of back and forth as synonyms. Why are we doing that? Or is that consciously done, or that is subconsciously?
I was not using all of them interchangeably, I hope. Not at all the intention. I won't call, want to put Vimayana a kind of a preface like a Dalit text, a kind of a prefix like a Dalit text, simply because if you look at it in terms of the people involved in the making of it, there are, then again, we go back to these questions of who is a Bahujan, who is this, would Adivasis making this make it a Dalit text? Again, in Kerala, when Narayan writes his autobiography, it's actually called Adivasi text, it's not exactly Dalit literature. When you had those Poison Bread volumes coming out of 1992 from Orient Longman, edited by Arjun Dangle, it was, if you look at it, it becomes mostly Dalit, Buddhist, even one can even say Mahar literature. So there are these very extreme difficulties in labeling something a Dalit text, unless the author is a self-identified Dalit. Here we have just used Ambedkar's text, so I would not want to call Vimayana a Dalit text. Somebody earlier did use it, but people use these words, I agree with you, Anika. That sometimes rather loosely. Sometimes we end up using Dalit as a substitute for scheduled caste. But the kind of charge with which that word can be used in different contexts is something that I won't associate with Vimayana being a Dalit text. That's a tough one. So I would avoid that. And your other question was in terms of, sorry, Anika.
We were using, during the conversation, the terms Dalit, Adivasis, or the tribal communities were used interchangeably. So I was wondering if that's a, I found it a little bit problematic, but as you said, you hope that it wasn't done intentionally. So I'll just pacify myself with that.
Sure. It was, I used the word Adivasi separately. I used the word Dalits, who are represented in the book, no doubt. Ambedkar being the central figure. Any other question, or is there a roundup?
There is some, do you have a Telugu version?
There was, in 2012, the book was, 2013 or 12, I'm losing the exact year, 2013, I would think, the book was published in 6 languages. Like I said, Telugu, Tamil, Malayalam, Kannada, Hindi, and Marathi. Out of these, only the Hindi publisher, who happens to be Ekalavya from Bhopal, has kept this text in print. A lot of them Because Prince Claus Fund was generous enough to do a second round of funding to subsidize the the cost of production of these language editions, they could print them at 195, 225 kind of price range in these languages, but none of them came back for a reprint. So I don't know if a Telugu edition is still available. Hyderabad Book Trust, Geeta Ramaswamy, if she's around in this discussion somewhere, like she said she would be, she published it in, Hyderabad Book Trust published it in 2013. I don't know if copies are still available. You can check with Hyderabad Book Trust. Likewise, DC Books did it in Malayalam. Yeah. And they haven't kept it in print either.
I think we'll have to wrap it up, and thank you so much, Anand, for this very compelling presentation, and thanks everybody for joining us.
Thank you Thirumal, thank you everyone for being here and for your
questions. And I should also thank my friend Pranay, who has been the technical backbone for this. Thank you, Pranay.
Thank you, everybody.